Bulavanaka, good morning, everyone. Welcome to day two of the Pacific Update. My name is Stephen Howes, and I'm the director of the Development Policy Centre here in Canberra at the Australian National University, and along with USP, we're one of the co-hosts or co-organisers of this conference. So thanks a lot for coming, for joining us today. I think yesterday we got off to a good start, and I'm sure we're going to build on that today and Friday. Let's begin the day by acknowledging the traditional owners of the lands of which I'm sitting, and where Canberra is based, and pay our respects to the elders, past, present, and emerging of the Ngunnawal people. And I'm sure you all want to pay respect to the Indigenous owners of the land, wherever you are. As I said, I'm at the Australian National University here in Canberra, and we're one of the co-organisers of this update. And of course, yesterday it was great to hear from the Vice-Chancellor of the University of South Pacific to welcome you. But on behalf of the ANU, I also want to welcome you to this Pacific update. It's a tradition that stretches back decades, and it's great that we had to give it a rest last year because of the chaos unleashed by COVID, but it's great we've been able to resurrect it this year. Of course, it's in a very different format. Normally you'd either be freezing cold in Canberra or you'd be enjoying the warmth of Suva. Now, some of us are freezing cold and others are enjoying the warmth. It is a very different update. But I think it's good to experiment, it's good to learn, and it's good to try different things. We are in a different year, and I don't think we're going to go back to business as usual. So it's great that we have this technology that we can draw on and that we can all come together, even though, you know, we're also physically dispersed. I also want to say, you know, obviously this has been a time of great suffering, you know, for all countries of the region. In different ways, you know, economic and or health, in some cases both. And I think, you know, I want us all to reflect on that for a minute and acknowledge the difficult times that various countries have been through and may still go through. It's certainly not over yet, but also pay tribute to, you know, all the great work that's been done, whether in the health sector or in development, in all sectors of the economy and all parts of society at the individual or social level, and pay tribute to people's determination, resilience, and strength that's and community mindedness that is getting us through this difficult period. And you know, we will eventually emerge. So I do want to encourage everyone to participate. It is a different environment. It doesn't have that friendliness, warmth, and collegiality of the normal Pacific update, where you bump into people you haven't seen for a long time, and you have lots of cups of coffee or tea. It doesn't have that kind of feel to it because we are so separated, but I do encourage you to participate. Please do ask questions. You can ask a question through the chat function, and not just ask a question, you can make a comment. And then you can put your hand up as well and you can ask the question in person. So please do participate. That's got lots of spillover benefits for everyone else. And do turn your video on, right? It's like encouraging everyone to come to the front of the lecture theatre. So yeah, if you turn your video on. Of course, we do have hundreds of people watching on Facebook for those who, you know, just want to kind of observe. But since you've made the trouble of coming onto Zoom, you can also actually be part of it and be seen. So do please participate. All right, the program for today, you know, we've got this format of we're putting the update over 3 days in two parts. So you don't have to, we want to avoid a sort of whole day Zoom meeting. So first of all, we have the theme for this morning is gender. And we have our keynote speaker. I'll introduce Fiona in a minute. And that session, that keynote will immediately be followed by a thematic session on gender, which Sandra Tarte will be chairing. So I'll hand over to her at 9:30 for that session. That goes for an hour. And then we have this art show. So we had a really great art show yesterday, and we'll have more of the same, or more art, more great Pacific art to share with you today. So that is something we're really happy to be able to bring. So please stay for that. And then 10:45, we'll take a break. And then we'll come back for our second session for the day. 12:30, we have an hour on economics in the Pacific that Ryan Edwards will be chairing. And that'll be it for day two. And then we'll come back and do it all again for our final day of day three. So I think that's all I need to say by way of introduction and announcements. We're really looking forward to today's sessions on gender and economics. And I can say personally, I'm in particular looking forward to this keynote session. And it's my real honor to be able to introduce to you Fiona Hukula. Dr. Fiona Hukula is the gender specialist at the Pacific Islands Forum Secretariat. She's still actually physically based in Port Moresby. So again, a sign of the times. And of course, many of you will know Fiona for her long and very distinguished stint as a senior researcher with the Papua New Guinea National Research Institute. And she also served as deputy chair of the Papua New Guinea Constitutional and Law Reform Commission. Fiona has a PhD in social anthropology from the University of St. Andrews in Scotland, and she's authored numerous publications, including blogs on crime, urban sociality, gender violence in PNG. Fiona's an outstanding advocate for the prevention of violence, especially violence against women and girls, and equally an outstanding advocate for women's leadership in all spheres of society. Fiona's topic for today is building a secure, inclusive Pacific, addressing gender inequality in COVID-19 times. So Fiona, I think welcome to Pacific Update. Thank you for joining us. And I'll hand over to you for your keynote. Please everyone give a virtual welcome to Fiona Hukula.
Thank you, Stephen. And thank you everyone for joining today. I'd like to thank ANU DevPol and USP for this invitation to speak today at Pacific Update. As Stephen said, it's really a strange time. So I have been working from home here in Port Moresby for the past 5 months in my new role as gender specialist for the Pacific Island Forum Secretariat. Let me apologize in advance if there's some little noises or if you hear some music coming from my home. I have my 3 girls on holidays today, so they're quite excited about this whole keynote, but they're in their rooms at the moment, so my apologies in advance. So yes, as Stephen said, I'd like to talk today about building a secure, inclusive Pacific and addressing gender inequality in COVID-19 times. As many of you know, our Blue Pacific, like the rest of the world, has had to reassess the way we do business, public service, and everyday life. The COVID-19 pandemic has posed many challenges in our sea of islands, but it has also presented us the opportunity to build on our strengths, which lie very much in our kinship and relational ties, as well as our ability to live off our land and sea. If anything, the pandemic has highlighted our need to continue to reflect on our dependence on imported goods, especially food, and how we can live a more healthy and sustainable life. For example, research in Fiji and Solomon Islands showed that there was the reinvigoration of local food systems and local food production, as well as the reemergence of cultural safety networks and values, such as the barter system. Ensuring that our Blue Pacific is protected as much as possible from the COVID-19 pandemic and future crisis has meant that our governments have had to divert much needed resources to ensuring that systems and protocols are in place to support our frontline workers. However, it has also become clear that in the effort to protect our borders and people from COVID-19, other important aspects of service delivery, such as health and education, have been affected. In a region that is prone to natural disaster and threats of climate change, there is a need to keep building resilience, not only around COVID-19, but the ongoing challenges of climate change and natural disasters. In 2020, the Forum Economic Ministers approved an the broad terms of reference for a socioeconomic impact assessment of COVID-19 on our Pacific communities. The Secretariat over the past year compiled a report which will provide the basis for advice to our forum leaders and Pacific governments on our continued COVID-19 response. This includes health and well-being, integrated pathways for economic recovery and resilience, adaptive learning and employment pathways, inclusive social protection systems, and sustainable livelihoods and food systems. There are many concerns around the impact on our Pacific economies, especially because many of our island countries are tourism dependent. And border closures have not only affected big business, and I'm happy to see that there on the panel this morning that there's a presentation around that, but also individuals and families through loss of income. You know, this has affected a lot of people, along with lockdown measures, has no doubt caused anxiety and stress for many across our region. And it's not only sort of the lockdown measures, but it's also all of the other things that come with that, especially around life rituals, such as death. And for us in the Pacific who attend house cries and do all of that kind of ritual at times of death, a lot of that has been constrained because of lockdowns and measures that have been put in place. And coupled with the work from home measures and in countries like Fiji, where children have been at home as well, the burden of care for children and the vulnerable, such as those with disabilities and the elderly, will most likely fall on women. Lockdowns, loss of income, and uncertainty around many things, including vaccine hesitancy, has also led to mental health concerns, and also brings up that need for adequate services, and also the strain on our health systems and importantly, our health workers. Early stigma associated with COVID-19 also was a concern here in Papua New Guinea. And this kind of stigma also very early impacted on whether people went for testing and also on ideas around how the COVID-19 illness came about. I think one of the greatest concerns relating to COVID-19 has been the increase in gender-based violence. In Papua New Guinea, the WANTOC counseling helpline, with the support of UNICEF, increased its call hours and capacity in anticipation for an increase in calls. The toll-free national helpline in Fiji recorded a 300% increase in domestic violence-related calls, 1 month after curfews and lockdowns were implemented. In April 2021, there were 527 recorded calls compared with 87 and 187 calls in February and March, respectively. In Samoa, during the first 6 weeks of lockdown, Samoa Victim Support Group responded to 415 calls through the helpline, with 46 distress calls resulting in police intervention to stop domestic violence in the home. Women's groups have linked the increase in domestic violence to the rise in unemployment and financial difficulties which have resulted from the pandemic. While family violence or violence between intimate partners is the most common form of violence reported, other forms of gender-based violence such as rape and sexual harassment remain a cause for concern. Gender-based violence, in my view, is one of, or if not the most important obstacle to not only reducing inequality between men and women, but building sustainable, resilient communities. During this time of living through the COVID-19 pandemic, it is important to keep in mind that other forms of violence, such as emotional violence and forms of coercive control, are also equally important forms of violence to recognize. While we do know that violence against women in our region is the most prevalent form of gender-based violence, we also recognize that marginalized groups, including persons with disabilities and LGBTQI, also suffer from violence. In order to progress gender inequality in our region, it is essential that we we view gender as being both about men and women, and also the role of leadership in supporting equality for all. It is important that Pacific women have leadership roles in all spheres of life. The lack of women's leadership at the highest political level also contributes to slowing down progress. It's very pleasing to see that Samoa has elected its first female prime minister. And it's also very pleasing to see that in the last Solomon Islands elections, three women were elected to parliament. This is a sign of progress. However, there are three countries in the region, which includes my own Papua New Guinea, who have no women at the highest level of political representation. The importance of women's voices for diversity and inclusion cannot be understated, and especially during these trying times. Efforts to address gender inequality in the region has a long history, with Pacific feminists and women's activists leading the response in terms of advocacy and service provision. But we still have a long way to go in addressing gender inequality and particularly gender-based violence. While we recognize the challenges and struggles, I think we need to acknowledge that there has been gains in terms of legislation and policy. For example, most countries have domestic violence legislation, and many countries have made great progress with establishing referral pathways. Some promising examples include the Solomon Islands and Kiribati Safe Net referral system. It's also been pleasing to see Pacific knowledge exchange, such as the safety net study tours from FSM and Kiribati to Solomon Islands, and the continued support and mentorship of the Fiji Women's Crisis Center to neighboring Pacific Island countries. Specific policies to address and mainstream gender is also evident in a number of Pacific countries, Vanuatu being the latest to launch its national gender equality policy last month. Regional commitments such as the Pacific Platform for Action on Gender Equality and Women's Human Rights and the Pacific Leaders Gender Equality Declaration provide the guiding framework for advancing the gender agenda in the region. For many years, donor and development partners have supported the work of civil society and governments to address gender inequality. The EU-funded Pacific Partnership on Ending Violence Against Women and Girls, with the support of the governments of Australia and New Zealand, enables the Pacific Island Forum Secretariat, the Pacific Community, and UN Women Pacific to work jointly under a common framework to address gender inequality and ending violence against women and girls. Under this program, each partner is responsible for one intervention area as defined by the program outcomes. So the SPC works to enhance Pacific youth's formal in-school and informal education on gender equality and prevention of violence against women and girls. This is really important to achieving transformational change, because as we know, we have a very young population, and if we want to see change around gender equality, we need to start very early and across all sectors of our community, including involving young people. The UN Women in this partnership works to promote gender equitable social norms at individual and community level, to prevent violence against women and girls, and also to ensure survivors have access to quality response and services. And again, this is another important aspect of addressing gender-based violence, because we can have all the policies and the laws in place, but if we don't have the access to quality services in terms of a response, we will continue to struggle to address issues such as gender-based violence. At the Forum Secretariat, our role in this program is to empower national and regional CSOs to advocate, monitor, and report on regional and government commitments to enhance gender equality and end violence against women and girls. So this is an important component of this work in the region, because as I've mentioned previously, the work to address gender inequality in the Pacific has been led by civil society and grassroots activism. It is important that national and regional CSOs have the right skills to advocate and monitor on gender commitments within the region, but also to actively engage and participate in dialogue with governments. Engaging a wide range of CSOs and faith-based organizations will enable conversations and advocacy to reach beyond traditional activist groups. And it's extremely important to involve men and boys and young people in these conversations. As the Australian government's flagship gender investment program, Pacific Women Shaping Pacific Development, comes to an end, there are many positive outcomes for ending violence against women and girls and women's empowerment. However, it is important that we continue to build on these efforts and institutionalize and take greater ownership of successful and promising initiatives. We can only do this if there is leadership and commitment from our Pacific governments. In 2021, the Pacific Islands Forum Secretariat has commissioned the review of the Pacific Leaders' Gender Equality Declaration to determine the effectiveness and relevance of the declaration, as well as to gauge views from member countries and relevant partners on ways to better coordinate gender commitments within the region. By way of background, the leaders of the Pacific announced the Pacific Leaders' Gender Equality Declaration, PLGED, at the 43rd Pacific Islands Forum in Rarotonga in 2012. As a result of the concerns, this was as a result of concerns that leaders had that overall progress in the region towards gender equality was slow. The PLGED renewed commitment to lifting the status of women in the Pacific and empowering them to be active participants in economic, political, and social life. To progress these commitments, leaders committed to implementing specific national policy actions to progress gender equality in the areas of gender responsive government programs and policies, decision making, economic empowerment, ending violence against women and girls, and health and education. The review could not have come at a better time. The review could not have come at a better time, where we have high levels of violence against women and girls, limited opportunities for women's economic advancement, and some of the lowest levels of political participation in the world. The review is also timely and complements current work around the 2050 strategy for the Blue Pacific continent, which encompasses much of what I have talked about today. Ladies and gentlemen, the trying times that we find ourselves in requires us to rethink about how we live in this world, but there are some elements of our lives which require continued conversation. For the Pacific region, I believe that gender equality continues to be an area of concern and a conversation that we must continue to have at all spaces, whether it be in academic conferences like this, in policy spaces, or within our homes and our communities. Stephen mentioned, I have a long history in the research background, and I'm very pleased to see that this morning that we have research coming from Tonga and from PNG. And I'd like to encourage our Pacific researchers to take ownership of our research agenda and for the issue around gender equality, to continue to champion research, to inform policy, to inform academia, because I'm a firm believer that we have a lot to offer around research, and that we should lead the research for the betterment of our people. And during this time where we're all struggling to live this online kind of life, I think it's always important to continue, as I said, to have these conversations, especially the hard conversations on how we can continue to work to address gender inequality in our region and in our home countries and our communities. So with that, I'd like to thank you again, Stephen and the USB and ANU team, for giving me this opportunity to share some thoughts today. Gupla morning, lo yupla ogeta, and I hope that the rest of the conference is successful. Thank you very much.
Okay, great. Fiona, thank you so much. That was a very moving address, actually. with a strong focus on gender-based violence, but also on women in leadership. We've got about 5 minutes, it's not a long time. If anyone wants to jump in quickly and ask a question, please put it in the chat function, or you'll need to quickly raise your hand and then I'll be able to spot you on the participant list and I can invite you to ask your question. We'll just have time for one or two. While we're waiting, I might just jump in. So Fiona, you said that the forum is going to review the existing strategy or the declaration, right, which is from 2012. But given that was from 2012, it's quite a while ago. Is there a plan to refresh that at the end of the review, or is that still up in the air?
So, yes, yeah, so currently the review is under, the review is underway. And so based on the review findings, the way forward will be sort of come clear from that, from the recommendations from the review, yes.
Okay, thank you. So do we have any questions from the floor, from our audience? Okay, Marion. Okay, so Marion, please go ahead. Are you there?
Yes, yes. Can you hear me okay? Thank you.
Thank
you very much, Fiona. You mentioned the DFAT strategy. I'm sorry, I can't recall the full name of it, and that coming to an end. Just wondered if you had any comments on, you know, the sort of, and you said there'd been some positive outcomes. So I wondered if you could comment further on some of those, what you see as, because, you know, the positive outcomes from that strategy and that program.
Thank you, Marion. So I mentioned the Australian government's gender investment program, Pacific Women Shaping Pacific Development. I think some of the positive things, well, I can speak to here in PNG was the family teams work that has been done around coffee. I think there's been a lot, and based on my previous role as a researcher in at the National Research Institute, we've had a strong collaboration with Regnet's Miranda Forsyth at the ANU, working on a big project on addressing sorcery accusation-related violence. And I think those are some positive aspects of support that have come out through positive aspects of work that have come out through the support of the Pacific Women Program. And I think also learning across the region, because there's an office in the office in Fiji, but we have an office here in PNG, and those, so there's been also an ability to have that cross fertilization of knowledge, which I think is really important. Thank you.
Great. Thanks, Fiona. And I know a couple of people have asked for the presentation, and definitely we will be making available all the presentations up on our website. So we'll be giving you more information about exactly where to get that, but you should be able to. Fiona, we might just finish with a couple of the questions on the chat, and then perhaps we'll just leave it there because we are out of time. I think you can see there are a few questions, quite a few now. There's one from Sadhana, how are you going to get traction on the gender issues given the predominantly male leaders across the Pacific? Sandra's asking whether the review will look at gender discriminatory legislation, and I guess Sadhana's going back to that issue, given that gender is only a smallish paragraph in the communique. How are the other leaders going to take this seriously? So I'll let you answer that bunch of questions and then we'll have to wrap it up, I'm afraid.
Thank you. I'll go to Sadhana's questions. I think, you know, Sadhana, that's a very important question and one that we have to keep reflecting on. For me, I think that one of the things that we need to do, or in my role as gender specialist, is to keep engaging, as I said, at different levels to be able to ensure that we are giving the right kinds of advice and also engaging respectfully with our governments to ensure that the work of addressing gender and gender equality continues to be one that is on the agenda for not only the forum, but for all of us. I think there was a question around the review. So the review is basically looking at that declaration and has taken into consideration recommendations from a wide range of people and organizations on what they think has been progressed within the basis of that review. So that's all I can sort of speak to around that question around legislations.
Okay, great. Anything else, Fiona? Any final words, or I don't want to cut you off?
No.
Thank you. Great. Well, we are out of time, so we're going to move on, but thank you very much, Fiona, for that fantastic presentation. I think you can see by some of the comments that are coming in just how much it's been appreciated by the audience, and I'm sure it will be widely shared and go down as a sort of key presentation. It's great to hear from you. We know you well from your old role. It's great to hear from you in your new role and what will be keeping you busy and what to look out for in the coming years. And what a great connection from Port Moresby. So terrific. Thank you so much. And thank your daughters for their excellent behaviour.
Thank you, Steve.
So we're now going to move on to the next session, and I'm going to hand over the role of chair to Sandra Tarte. Dr. Tarte is the acting head School of Law and Social Sciences at USP, but Sandra also really needs no introduction. Many of you will know her from previous updates and, of course, from her outstanding scholarship around Pacific and regional issues. So thank you very much, Sandra, for agreeing to take part in the update and chair this session, which is a follow-on session on gender. And I'm going to hand over to you.
Great, thank you, Stephen, and good morning, everyone from Suva. It's actually a very beautiful day here today. And thank you for the opportunity to chair this important session. And once again, welcome everybody to this session on gender at the 2021 Pacific Update. As Stephen said in his introduction, I'm currently the acting head of the School of Law and Social Sciences at USB. We're a new school since our recent restructure. And I'm glad to see Nilesh here as well, my colleague from the former school. And just a few reminders before we begin, the session is being recorded and also live streamed via the Development Policy Center's Facebook page. This morning on our session, we have three presentations. Each presenter will have 15 minutes to present, and then there'll be a 5-minute Q&A immediately after each presentation. And perhaps there's no need to remind you on this, but during the presentation, you can type questions into the chat section, which we will get to at the end. And when we get to the Q&A, you may, if you have a question, raise your hand in the reactions navigation bar. I'll now move on to introduce our first presenters. We in fact have two presenters for this first presentation. They are Mereani Rokotuibau and the Reverend Dr. Ungatea Fonua Kata. Mereani is the Executive Director of the Regional Balance of Power Initiative, which aims to increase women's leadership in all domains of decision-making and is funded by DFAT. Mereani previously worked with the Pacific Leadership Program, working to strengthen local coalitions across Samoa, Solomon Islands, Tonga, and Vanuatu, and also with the Solomon Islands Resource Facility. Reverend Dr. Ungatea is a Tongan educator, church leader, linguist, and mother. She is currently the director of the Tupou Tertiary Institute and a minister of the Free Wesleyan Church of Tonga. She is a long-standing and globally respected advocate for women's leadership across all spheres. Their paper this morning will be on voters' perception of women as leaders in Leadership in Tonga. I'll now hand over to our first two presenters. Thank you.
Thank you. Well, everyone, I'm just wondering if I could share screen. Okay. Just checking if you can also see my screen. Okay,
yeah,
thank you. All right. And as Sandra has said, today's presentation would be shared between me and Dr. Ungatea. That's the study that we will be taking us through. And it's in two parts. We're talking about the findings of the research survey. The other bit of it is also to try and unpack the strategies, to try and unpack the process itself and the approach that we had to undertake as we work towards doing a bit more investigation in the way the voters react, particularly with the women in leadership, with a stronger focus on women's political leadership. A bit of a background, and I'm happy that Dr. Fiona, in her address this morning, touched on this, and she talked about how there's been a lot of investments over the last couple of decades in the area of women's political leadership. And then we look at how, you know, donor agencies, development partners have poured into this area. However, when we look at the results, there's still a very low, extremely low levels of women's representation in parliament. In March this year, we only have 6.8% of parliamentary seats occupied by women, which is way low, way low, very low compared to the global average of 25%. An initiative like ours, it's to look at, you know, that some things will need to change. What is it that we need to change? We also had to look at, you know, the perceptions of our national, our communities at the local level. How do they look at these types of programs? Quite often there's a negative perception. There's always this conversations to say, this is not a Pacific agenda. This is not a Fiji agenda or a Tongan agenda. This is a UN agenda, or this is a Palangi agenda. That's something that we had to really understand. Why are people even thinking that way when we are looking at addressing an issue that is critical to the development of our communities, to the development of our Pacific? It's really sensitive area. We're trying to look at what are the issues, why are people resistant to change, recognizing that there are parts of our culture that needs to change to promote and accept women as legitimate leaders, not only in other sectors, in private sector or in the public sector, but also in the political sector. And over the decades, we can also see how there's been an increase of women's participation, particularly in leadership positions across all the other sectors, but not in politics. So these are some of the things that we thought we need to unpack and look at how we can start to shift these. Where are the barriers? Why are people resistant to this? Recognizing that culture doesn't evolve, and we need to work with culture to change culture. Just moving on a bit about the Balance of Power program that I work for. Sandra has already said a bit about our program. We are entirely and intentionally locally led. So we are grateful that that was the way our program was designed back in 2019. In place in country to be able to localization agenda. As Dr. Fiona also talked about the importance of working with the people in the men in our communities. And I think it was also a question raised by Sadna in the chat room. How do you bring men to agree to champion the gender equality agenda? And that's the very space that we work in, is to support, look for the influences in our communities, in our structure. How do we incentivize them? How do we support them? How do we support the local power holders? They are the ones that are influential, that be able to shift these sensitive areas within our culture, within our religious beliefs. The other bit that I also wanted to share, for us, it was about, you know, getting that strong evidence base. When we're looking at changing culture, changing people's mindset and perceptions, we need to identify where are the people at? What is their current understanding? Dr. Fiona also said that, you know, we're a youthful population. So how do we also bring the young people along with us when we go into, when we unpack of women's, women in political leadership. The last slide before I hand over to Dr. Ungatea is just to talk about this partnership. We're all about promoting Pacific research. So, and we were already placed to be able to roll this out. When we went into Tonga TTI, Tupou, Tonga's Institute, they've already been doing research, working with the ADB, working with other universities in New Zealand, as well as in Australia. So for us, it was about that. How do we support the locals, researchers to do this and to roll out this research? They understand the dynamics, they understand the politics, they understand the relationships that even me, even though I'm a Pacific Islander, but I'm in Suva, I'm Fijian, I don't really understand some of the way the Tongan culture works. So for us, it was ensuring that, yes, the research is locally led and locally owned. They are the ones that understand the context, and also to shift away from the also the perception that researchers are always expecting that we are coming in to get all this data and we're putting it in paper, but then we're dealing with it in a completely different way, rather than getting the local researchers to do this, to look at the issues that are relevant to them and work out approaches to address these issues. So that points to the importance of building trust so that people are able to openly share what their issues are, instead of just saying one to hear, using the local.
Mereani, can you hear us?
Yes, Sandra.
Perhaps we should move on to, you're okay. Okay.
Okay. So just to finish up, it's just the importance of the building ownership, and also recognizing that for us, we also have a role to provide the support to our local team, but knowing that I think I'll stop then and hand it to Dr. Ungatea.
Thank you, Mereani. We'll proceed with Dr. Ungatea now. Thank you.
Thank you. Mereani, if you can click onto the page where I'm supposed to be. Malo abito, malo lele to everyone. I think my part of this presentation is already outlined clearly in the rest of the PowerPoint presentation, which Mereani is sharing. And I'm sure
will be available to other participants in this conference. I think, to me, I will just speak in the little minutes that I was given on what I think is critical about this partnership, and that is, what is really led? What does that mean to us? It meant to us, to TTI, that we had discussed this very issue ourselves. This issue of why that I have felt, or and a few of us here in Tonga, as women who promote or want to have more voices, more women voices in areas of decision making. Why is it that we felt that certain diagnostic tools of where we were or where our voices were at this current stage were often tools from outside? They were not Tongan. That's what we felt. And therefore, because we felt there was an issue, we approached a regional partner, which was Balance of Power, that was here in Tonga and wanting to work with organizations. And they allowed us to have our voices in the methodologies that we use, which is something like Mereani signing consent form won't work in our villages because it will mean us sort of, they can interpret it as us giving them some kind of bank statements, which is their only kind of understanding of signing of forms. Mereani, sorry, but we have to be careful of understanding where we're going because there are vicious dogs in our villages that might be going after our interviewers. So understanding those contexts in our situation and being able to talk to partners who are funded by non-Tongan governments to be able to listen and allow us that opportunity, yet we are able to still say we are going to do it ethically in an honest way to our own villages. I think that, to me, was a critical component of us being able to do this work, to us better understanding and getting information which we wanted, which was to show how is our cultural understanding of women or role or influence of women in the Tongan culture, how can we get that information, that baseline information, which often our systems in the Pacific, in Tonga, for example, I will speak only for Tonga, does not have the structures to collect baseline information quickly and to make decisions on that baseline to further understand the situations. So I think our ability to have the information that we have in that report to show that women, that the voters still believe that, I think this is just that to work, we were able to also work with the Youth Congress, in which students, TTI students were also conducted were part of the research, as well as young people that empowered themselves as well. And that was the process in which we used. Mereani, just raise your hand if I'm going over time, eh? So I can see you, because I'm not talking from the PowerPoint. So those research findings that you can see is a result of partnership, or real partnership, or genuine partnership, I feel, between those of us in Tonga who conducted the research and an organization that allowed us to do the research in the way that we felt was the most appropriate way to have it in Tonga in an ethical manner, but that ethical window or glasses was conducted in the Tongan way. I think the research here, the finding is clearly there. 61% felt that the Tongan family was still hierarchical. It is a hierarchical country It is reflected in the way we find their perception of women in the family, and that theme was carried out throughout the whole of women being core role of being mother and carer was the key perception that voters had. I think also the way we conducted this or using stories was something that we felt was very appropriate to get people's genuine impact and feedback. I think what was clear from the results is that there's increasing acceptance of women being economic earners, and also an increasing awareness or acceptance of women to be in parliament, both women and males, and no longer just seen as an arena for male. Although there's still a high percentage who felt that parliament was still an area for men, there was an increasing number of people who felt that it was an area for both female and males. I think that's basically what I can say, Sandra. If anybody has other questions, they can read what's on the screen and ask questions from there.
Great. Thank you. Thank you both. We do have a few minutes, so if there are any questions, please raise your hand or post them in the chat forum. Nothing yet. Stephen, I'll go to you. Stephen will be asking a question.
Yeah, I don't want to take up all the space, but I want to congratulate the presenters. It was a great presentation and great research. And yeah, I just wondered whether you found the actual act of itself asking those questions, having those discussions, whether that itself changes views. Like, so do you think you just capture what people are thinking, or do you think this kind of dialogue actually changes the way people view the role of women in leadership?
Yeah, thank you, Stephen. Absolutely, I think the discussion and using this research raised awareness, because we use 10 students here at TTI, 10 students from Youth Congress, and they, most of them, had never really thought about these issues. So the training and the participation in the research definitely impacted their own views on this issue. And absolutely, when they went out, debriefing with them every week, when they went out to the homes, a lot of comments was on their thinking about it that way, simply from the stories that they were given. So I think, yes, it impacted a lot about awareness.
I might maybe go to the question Marian has posted on the chat, either Mereani or Ungatea. Could you comment on the role of the churches? Is there some support from them for women to have a greater role?
I can only speak from the church which I belong to, which is the Free Wesleyan Church. I think there are the church has two sides. So people who are supportive and people who are conservatives, I think with every organization, but more so in a conservative environment for churches anyway. But there are increasing number of church ministers who understand better And I think it's a matter of raising greater awareness. But that's why we did this research, so that we can better understand how it is that the Tongans themselves view the role of women, so that we can have strategies and approaches that will address their perceptions in a way to raise awareness and to greater influence more women to be to participate in decision-making levels in the church and in other organizations.
Mereani, did you want to comment on this question?
Yes, thank you, Sandra. And for us, it's part of the work that we do here at Power, is to look at that. How do we work with the churches? From, as Ungatea has said, the survey that we've done is part of the work that we're going to implement in Tonga. And for me, speaking from here in Fiji and from my own church, I've seen with the Methodist Church of Fiji, there's been shifts, slow, but at least it's progressing. And what we intend to do as well for Balance of Power is to look at how we can engage with Pacific Conference of Churches and the Fiji National Council of Churches to really unpack and understand how the church can support this and really include women, particularly in leadership roles within the church. But we've seen shifts over decades of how a lot of women are stepping up into these roles.
Thank you. There are other questions, and there's one here from Joanne on the difference of views between youth and older generations, but I might suggest we come back to questions at the end of the whole session, and hopefully we'll have time then to address this and other questions. So once again, thank you very much, Mereani and Ungatea, and all the best with your work. And please stay on for our discussions in the rest of this session. And I'd like to now welcome and introduce our second presenter this morning, Sarah Boxall. Sarah, in 2020, was appointed by the Economic Empowerment as the Economic Empowerment of Women Specialist for the Asian Development Bank's Pacific Private Sector Development Initiative. She is also a non-executive director for UN Women Australia. A passionate advocate for gender equality, she has over 20 years' experience in international cultural exchange, education, and development in a range of organizations, including government, multilaterals, universities, and not-for-profits in Australia and overseas. She has lived and worked in Fiji, France, Solomon Islands, the United Kingdom, and Vanuatu. Prior to joining the ADB, Sarah was based in Fiji, where she held senior leadership roles as Deputy Country Representative for UN Women's Fiji Multi-Country Office, CARE International's Pacific Regional Programs Director, and as Deputy Team Leader of the Pacific Women Shaping Pacific Development Support Unit. Sarah worked for the UN, for the Australian government in a range of roles, including in the Fragile States Unit and Multilateral Effectiveness Section, and was posted to the Solomon Islands working on Ramsi. Sarah holds a Bachelor of Science and a Master of International Social Development. And this morning she'll be speaking on Leadership Matters, Benchmarking Women's Business Leadership in the Pacific. So please welcome Sarah.
Thank you, Sandra, for the introduction. And I'd like to begin, first of all, by acknowledging the traditional owners of the land on which I work, which is the Wadi Wadi people of the Darawal Nation here in Wollongong. And I'd like to pay my respects to elders past, present, and emerging. So I'll hopefully share my screen with you. And I'd also really like to acknowledge the presentations that we've already had this morning, which have touched on a number of really critical issues in the Pacific around women's leadership. And I'm excited that we're having the opportunity to launch a new report that we've prepared, today on leadership matters. So we're looking at a different domain of leadership in the Pacific, but I think one that's also interesting to explore how women are taking on leadership roles in the Pacific in different domains. So before we start to look at the findings for the Pacific of our study, I'd like to put a little bit of outline some what we see in the global literature, because the area of women's business leadership globally is very well studied. So some of this provides some interesting context for the findings that we have in the Pacific. So one of the key findings of the global research is that companies with more women in leadership have improved performance, productivity, and profitability. There's an increasing number of studies that show this and quantify it, in fact, in dollar figures. For example, there's a 2020 study in Australia that shows appointing a woman CEO increases the market value of a listed company by 5%, approximately $80 million. And what we're seeing globally as well, tracking this over time, is that we are seeing an increase in the number of women in senior management and board positions. However, what we do see in the data is that we're still seeing women are not reaching the highest levels of leadership. So while we might see greater numbers of women on boards and in senior management, when we look at those highest levels of CEO or board chairs, we start to see a drop off. Now, the global research also identifies a number of factors that we can see that will determine the likelihood that there will be women in these senior positions. As touched on several times already this morning, the wider social norms and culture in any given country or context influence what happens within these types of organizations. Another factor is the overall proportion of women in the workforce. So organizations that have a greater number of women in their workforce are more likely to have women in these senior positions. When we see diversity and other policies in place, such as flexible work arrangements that support an inclusive workplace culture, we're also more likely to see women in these senior roles. And of course, the use of targets and quotas is also strongly correlated with having women in leadership. What we're also seeing increasingly is an emerging trend where institutional investors are increasingly pushing companies to increase diversity in their leadership ranks. And we're also starting to see this in consumer behavior as well. So to look at the study that we conducted then, given the obvious benefits to businesses of having more women in leadership, we thought it would be helpful to develop a snapshot of the Pacific of current leadership on senior management and boards. We looked at this at a regional level, country level, by different organization types and sectors. So our study concentrates on the 14 countries in which ADB operates, and we've looked at the sample includes organizations across five categories. So we have publicly listed companies, which only exist in Fiji and PNG in the Pacific. It also includes industry associations and peak bodies, regional private sector organizations, other private sector entities such as private companies. And we've also included state-owned enterprises, given the significant commercial presence they have in the Pacific. So we were able to collect data for 275 organizations across these categories. Now, it is important to note that there are some businesses that we didn't include in the sample. This is global companies that perhaps operate in the Pacific, but if they don't have a locally based board, we didn't include them. And it also doesn't include smaller organizations or family-owned businesses. Whilst they obviously play a significant role in the private sector, we only included those that had a formal independent board. So data was collected primarily from publicly available information. So as most people would be aware, that is sometimes there are issues with the quality and availability of data. So we don't have full data sets for all 274 organizations, but we have a reasonably complete set. So we also supplemented the data with 12 case studies that look at successful approaches to increasing women's representation in business, 10 of which are from the Pacific. So as we've discussed a few times this morning, women's leadership in the political sphere in the Pacific is often the focus of the attention, and it is, in many cases also, where we have very low levels of representation of women. So what we've done in this first chart is we compared the representation of women in political leadership as women MPs, and we compared that with our study findings on the percentage of women as directors and women CEOs in each country. And what we can see here is that in almost every case, the representation of women in business leadership was much higher than for political leadership. Now, we do acknowledge that these are not directly comparable types of leadership. The leadership around political participation is obviously has particular challenges and contexts and constraints. However, we do think that it shows a promising story that there is actually women showing exercising leadership in many ways. And it's important to focus that there are some positive stories about women exercising leadership. So based on the data that we collected, we determined regional averages across the different leadership categories. So here we're presenting data on board chairs, deputy chairs, directors, and CEOs. Now, it is quite clear from this chart that men still dominate in all of these leadership categories. However, we did also compare this data with global averages in which the Pacific fares quite well. So for board chairs, for example, the Pacific average is 11% women are board chairs, and that's almost double the global average, which is 5.3%. For women directors, the Pacific average is 21% and the global average is 16.9%. So again, a higher average. And women in the Pacific are almost three times as likely to be a CEO as compared to the global average. So in addition to the regional averages, we also did analysis and developed averages at the country level. So this is for the 14 countries in the study. So the regional average for women directors is 21%. And what we can see here is half of the countries in the sample exceed the regional average. We have Palau, Samoa, and Cook Islands that have national averages of over 30%. We do also see here that the remaining half are below the regional average of 21%. But I would also note that in all but two cases, they still exceed the global average, which is quite a positive story. So analysing the data by country for chief executive officers, we again see there's quite significant variation in the levels of representation here. And I would just note that in many cases here, we are talking about quite small sample size. So where we have either very high or very low percentages, this still may represent only a handful of positions. So we can see here that these proportions could change quite significantly from the turnover of individual positions. That said, what we do see here again is that eight countries exceed the regional average of 13%. And again, Cook Islands, Palau, and Samoa have very high representations of women as CEOs, along with Kiribati and Tuvalu. Now, there's quite a few countries that have either very low or no representation of women as CEOs. Again, in some cases, this represents the very small sample size that we were working with. However, this group does also include some of the biggest economies in the Pacific. Between the samples of Fiji, Solomon Islands, and PNG, that represents almost half of the CEO positions included in this study. So we can actually see there is considerable scope here to increase the representation of women in these leadership roles. We also analysed the data by organisation type to see if there were any trends in the types of organisations that were more effective in promoting women. And what we can see here is that industry associations, the majority of which are national chambers of commerce, by far have the highest representation of women across all levels. And in a couple of cases, we see gender parity or greater, such as in CEO and senior management positions. And I think that's an interesting finding because it shows that it is possible to achieve equal representation in leadership and decision-making roles. So I think another important thing to highlight here is that across all of these organization types, we actually see women reasonably well represented in senior management positions. That varies between 23% to 53%. But when we drill down to CEO positions, we see those rates in most cases drop off quite significantly. I will just also highlight the findings for state-owned enterprises. They are about a third of the sample, so they do represent a significant number of opportunities for women in leadership roles. Now, women are represented across all leadership categories within state-owned enterprises. However, we do have existing data on this. In 2012, the Pacific Island Forum Secretariat completed a study on women's leadership on SOE boards. Now, that study found that women comprised approximately 18% of directors of SOE boards, and our study from 2021 shows that women still hold approximately 18% of director positions on SOE boards. So there have been several government commitments to increase women's leadership in this area. However, we see that that rate remains largely unchanged. The study also covers approximately 12 sectors. And again, some sectors we had very small sample size, so it's hard to draw too many conclusions. However, of the 12 sectors covered by the study, women are represented on boards in 11 of those sectors. It does vary from 10% to 32%. By sector, we see that private sector tourism organisations have by far the highest rate of representation of women. This is followed by an unspecified category that didn't have a dedicated sector, again, mostly chambers of commerce. And we also see quite strong representation of women in media and communications, finance and utilities. When we compare that data by sector at the management level, again, we see that the same five sectors have the highest proportion of women in leadership. And again, for those we see at the lower end where there may be no women in CEO positions, there's still that difference between senior management, where women are reasonably well represented, and that drop off CEOs. In some cases, this is because the sample was small, but in the example of the transport and infrastructure sector, that was actually 30 CEO positions, none of which are held by women. So based on this, on the case studies and the data, we were able to draw a few generalized conclusions, and we can see that women do remain underrepresented in leadership, but what we do see is that there are examples at the country level in different sectors and different organization types where we're really seeing significant progress. The case studies also provided some important insights, such as it's not possible to make sustainable changes in women's leadership without senior level commitment within the organization and also funding and resourcing. We also learned from the case studies that this, where there was success in increasing the proportion of women in leadership, there was often efforts by the organization to collect, analyze, and track data over time to get a sense of where the pathways were and where the blockages might be to women's leadership. And this is a generalized finding then with many development challenges in the Pacific. I think this point's already been made. If we don't have data, it's very hard to develop targeted programming and policy responses. So this is just a snapshot of the findings of this study. The full report includes country profiles for each of the 14 countries and includes recommendations that are targeting different stakeholders, such as governments, private sector organizations, and development partners. So the full report is available today on our website. And we acknowledge that this is a collection of data and analysis in terms of what that means in particular countries is required to understand how and why leadership manifests itself in different ways in different contexts. But we hope that this report highlights the increasingly prominent role that women are playing in leadership in the business sector in the Pacific. So I'll just finish there. Thank you.
Thank you. Very much, Sarah. And I think this is a hugely valuable contribution that has been launched today. We are really pressed for time. Are there any immediate questions? If necessary, we might have to deal with these questions and answers on the chat board and see if we can answer them that way. There is one question that's just come up. Not quite sure who that's from. Pacific Women, okay. Be interesting to understand the link between women in business leadership and benefits to women in the wider community. Sarah, did you want to?
Sure. Look, I think as touched on in several of the presentations this morning, part of the challenge around women in leadership is the acceptance of women as leaders and part of the social norms about seeing women as leaders and in those economic roles or those political roles. So I think the more we see women taking on leadership roles in business, the more we're progressing the acceptance of women as leaders, which can then translate to benefits for progressing gender equality and the overall perception of women in all domains. And I think that applies to any domain in which women are displaying leadership, be it community level, within churches, or in political leadership.
Thank you, Sarah. There's another question from Jerry. I might ask you to respond to that on the chat, if that's okay, Sarah, and we might need to keep moving on.
No problem.
Other messages coming up as well. But once again, thank you very much, and we look forward very much to this report being in circulation. I would like to now introduce our third presenter this morning, Minetta Daniella Kakarere from Papua New Guinea. Minetta is currently a political science honors student at the University of PNG and is a part-time tutor with the political science department at UPNG. The title of her presentation, Factors That Instigate Intimate Partner Violence in the National Capital District of PNG. But please welcome Minetta.
Thank you, Sandra. Good morning, everyone. So as mentioned, I will be presenting on factors that instigate intimate partner violence here in the National Capital District of Papua New Guinea. I'm trying to share my screen. Sorry about that. Just a brief on the presentation. The research was conducted in 2020 as a requirement of the Bachelor of Arts with Honours in Political Science program that I was taking here at the University of Papua New Guinea. And it is currently under evaluation at the moment. So the aims of the research was to identify the determinants of intimate partner violence in NCD, and also to identify the main forms of abuse experienced by the victims of intimate partner violence, and also to see whether these cases, the cases that I analyzed, made it up to the court and the victims got justice, or whether victims got justice and the perpetrators were punished, or the perpetrators weren't punished, and what were some of the reasons of this. So the research methodology was document analysis, and the analysis and interpretation of personal documents, which appear to be case files maintained by the police, specifically the feminine sexual violence units. So the personal documents would include court documents, referral letters of the victims to our safe houses and the hospitals for if the victims sustained injuries and wounds. And yes, other important documents of the victims of IPV. So one of the limitations of this research was 152 case registries were analyzed for the purpose of the honors dissertation. So there could be other determinants of intimate partner violence in NCD. And also due to the fact that our intimate partner violence is most of the our cases are not reported, and there could be more more determinants of our intimate partner violence. So this is the results of the research that I did last year, and there were 15 determinants of intimate partner violence in NCB. The main one, or the most common one, was extramarital affair. Okay, so before I go on to explaining the graph, from the 152 cases that were analyzed, 141 were male perpetrators, and 11 cases were female perpetrators. So with extramarital affair, the husbands actually were having extramarital affair, thus neglecting their wives and the kids. So the wives and the kids were, the wives especially were psychologically affected by this. So they reported the matter to the police. So out of the 152 cases, 38 cases were extramarital affairs, with four of them, the females committed extramarital affair. Then the next determinant was alcohol, and with alcohol, most of the perpetrators were males. Yeah, 24 of them were males, and they committed the assault whilst being under the influence of alcohol. So one of the victims noted that every day, or whenever the husband was under the influence of alcohol, he would beat her up. So if it's in the morning or in the afternoon or in the night, he would really beat her up, because he was under the influence of alcohol. And then financial reasons, 23 cases. Most of the victims of IPV who were women, who were actually unemployed. So they depended on their husbands for financial support. But because most of the men, they don't usually meet the family's needs, and they spend it on gambling and alcohol as well. So this psychologically affected the family. So the wives went and reported the complaint. Also, victims who were employed, women, they experienced some physical abuse from the intimate partners, the husbands, because they didn't give the husbands money when the husbands asked for it. So they were physically assaulted for that. Then the next factor was the perpetrator was always aggressive and violent towards the wives. He would, from 152 cases and 14 of the cases, the male perpetrators were very aggressive towards their wives, and demanded their wives to listen to them for instance, one of the cases, the husband expected the wife to answer the call when he called, but when he called and she didn't actually hear the phone ringing, and then the next call that the husband called her, and then she answered it, and he was actually verbally abusing her and all this. And then the next factor was jealousy. With jealousy, the husbands had distrust feelings towards the wife, especially those working working women. The husband had distrust feelings towards them, with their colleagues, male colleagues especially. And for those women who were actually at home, and the husbands were working, and they had distrust feelings towards their wives who were at home. Then the other factor was minor arguments with this. It mostly resulted in physical assault. So minor arguments over family issues, like not preparing dinner on time, or not taking care of the children, and spending more time on social media. It resulted in minor arguments where mostly the victims were female. Then possessive and controlling towards their wives, and most of these, not most, but out of the 13 cases, only one was a female perpetrator who was very possessive towards her husband. But on the 12 cases, the husband was very possessive and controlling towards their wife. So and the wife usually obeyed him and did everything that he wished, because of what failure to comply to what the husband asked her to do, he would beat her up for this. So most of the victims in this category experienced some severe injuries, such as wounds and very serious injuries, and were referred to the hospitals for medical treatment as soon as possible. Then polygyny was the other factor that instigated intimate partner violence. With this, the husband actually physically assaulted the first wife, and I didn't support her as well and her family. And yes, she was psychologically affected and physically hurt and reported the matter. Then with our cultural mentality, this refers to the roles of women in the PNG culture, mainly to take care of kids and the household is the woman's responsibility, even though she is the breadwinner, or if the husband is not working, she still has to fulfill that responsibility. And yes, both men and women in PNG do still hold on to that. And this is one of the causes to intimate partner violence cases as well, because of the woman, because she was tired from her job. And then when she came back home, the husband expected her to take care of the kids, which she was so tired and she didn't. And then the husband beat her for it. Because like I stated, men are not supposed to be responsible of taking care of the children. And it's seen as the woman's responsibility. Okay, the next factor is insecurities. With this, all of these, the three cases, the perpetrator was the male, and he actually, the males had, the husbands were very insecure when the wives were at work, or if they saw their wife having a conversation with their male colleagues, and they were very, very insecure. And most times when the wives returned home, they would threaten her, and one of the victims had a broken arm because he was caught talking with his male colleague. Then separation. So with this, the perpetrator was the female. She actually took the children and left the husband. And the husband was psychologically affected by this and then reported the matter to Family and Sexual Violence Unit here in NCD. Then gossip was the other factor. With this the husband found out that his wife was gossiping about his sisters-in-law, and then he beat her up for that. Then pornography, the wife actually found porn images in her husband's phone, and because she was a Christian, it was way out against her Christian beliefs. So they argued about this, and then he beat her up. And then wife neglecting children, which is on the second last factor here. The husband actually beat the wife because she didn't take care of the children, and one of the child was almost hit by a car. So because of this, he actually beat her up and broke her. And then the last factor was drug abuse. Drug abuse, the perpetrator, who was the husband, was actually under the influence of drug and then committed assault. Physically assaulted his wife because she was not listening to him. So these are the factors that instigated intimate partner violence based on 152 cases that I analyzed for the purpose of the honors dissertation that I was working on last year. And then these are the forms of abuse faced by the victims of intimate partner violence. Most of them suffered from physical abuse, then psychological abuse, and physical and psychological. And one victim suffered from physical, psychological, and sexual abuse. So to note that there are no sexual abuse cases here, because sexual abuse cases such as rape and sexual harassment are what are categorized as serious offenses. So they were referred to another unit in the police stations known as the sexual offense squad. So they mainly deal with the sexual abuse cases. So from the 152 cases that I analyzed, 60 victims and suffered from physical abuse, and 46 victims suffered from psychological abuse such as threats, cursing, insults, swearing, name calling, etc. And 45 suffered from both physical and psychological abuse, and one victim suffered from all three, but this case was referred to sexual offense squad. So this was the outcome of the cases that I analyzed, 152 cases. Only 20 cases were successful, meaning the perpetrators were punished for the crime, meaning they were sent to prison or were asked by the court to pay a specific fine. And then 50 cases were actually unsuccessful, meaning the perpetrators were not punished, even though the accusations were true and correct. But there were a lot of reasons to why the perpetrators were not punished. Mostly the complainants actually withdrew their complaints from the police. This is the reason, because most of the perpetrators happen to be the sole breadwinners of the family. So if the victim continues with the process and gets the perpetrator arrested and sent to the prison, and then there's no one else to provide for the family. So because of this, most victims go back to the police stations to withdraw their cases. Also, the other reason why victims withdraw their cases was because of the threats that they face from the families of the husband. So to avoid all this, they go and they ask the police officers to remove their cases or for police records. And victims never showed up before the court. Similar reasons, because they are threatened, or they know that they, once the perpetrator, their husband is put into prison and there's no one to support them. Support them and their.
Minetta, I'm afraid we'll need to wrap up your presentation. Just given the time we're up now. Are you happy to stop at this point and just take a few questions?
Yes.
Great, thank you. So a few minutes left. Any questions, please, for Minetta? Or hands or messages? Minetta, maybe I'll ask a quick one. Was there anything surprising in what you found that you weren't expecting at the start of this research? Anything that?
Yeah, what surprising thing was that many women do not get justice for this, because they usually think of their families' needs and welfare. So they don't usually like push on with the case, like even though like it's really hurting them, like as the mother. So yeah, that was something that I found out in this research, and it is very surprising as well.
Okay, thank you. Any got time for one more question, if there are any, before we finish. Perhaps at that point we might just there is one that's just come up on the chat, Minetta. Do you have information about the backgrounds of the people involved, urban education, etc.? Did you analyze the kind of legal support? This is from Michelle Rooney. Did you analyze the kind of legal support that women had in these cases, lawyers or others who may have supported them?
No, I did not. The research didn't go into that area. The research was hoping to find out the main factors that instigate intimate partner violence. So I was only speaking with the officers in the family and sexual violence unit that mainly deal with mainly register the cases. So no, I did not discuss or have a conversation with the legal guys.
And just to say another comment from Megan Reinhardt, I think it would be really interesting to compare the determinants for intimate partner violence that led to sexual offences, perhaps for another research project.
Yeah.
Okay, I think we'll have to draw it to a close there. And once again, thank you to our presenters for their very important and valuable work. And thank you also to our audience. Thank you for your participation, and thank you for all your questions and comments. Please be advised that following this session, we have a Pacific Arts presentation and virtual exhibition. This is presented by USP's Oceania Center for the Arts and Culture. So on that note, I wish you all a very good afternoon from Suva, and all the best for the remainder of this Pacific update. Thank you.
Great. Thanks a lot to Sandra for chairing the session, and to our three speakers. That was a really interesting session with great, very different, but all very, really interesting research. So as Sandra said, we are going to wrap up this morning's session with our second art show, which is brought to us by Lingi Kone Fakuata. And Lingi is an artist himself and also a curator, and we're really grateful to him that he has taken the time to put together this exhibition for us. We really enjoyed it yesterday, and we're looking forward to it today. So please do stay for that. And after the exhibition, 15 minutes, then we'll take a break, and we'll see you back at 12:30 for the economic session. So over to you, Lingi.
Thank you. Let me just share this screen. There you go. For those that were not here yesterday, my name is Lincoln Pout. I am from Tonga. I live in Fiji. Been an artist for a while at the Oceanic Center, and also a research PhD student on Pacific Studies. So the same format as yesterday for those who didn't come will be like a 5 minute presentation followed by the 8 minutes, and Ari will play that video later. And also I would like, before I start, we acknowledge to those that inquired and bought some of the works yesterday. The artists much appreciate what you have done, and some work that email will be provided later on the screen. So the topic for today is artist representation, looking at artists living in the island versus Pacific artists in diaspora. So why is this important? So representation, we all know that representation is important, that you come from. Without it, usually you kind of invisible in your work, invisible, or others or your peers won't recognize you. So everybody here.
I'm sorry, Lingi. Can you hear us?
Lingi seems to have gone on mute and not to have a good connection right now. So are you there, Lingi? Are you able to, oops.
If you're able to come back, you could probably try turning off your camera and see if that improves the connection. Hi, Lingi. Right.
I think he's done that. Maybe we'll go to the art show.
Exhibition. Ari, sure.
Because you can play that, right?
Sure.
So we'll just watch the paintings, and then if Lingi can come back, he can give his talk after the exhibition.
Sounds great. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Well, thank you. That was another great set of artwork. And it is available if you want to buy something, send an email to Ari. But Lingi's now joined us again. So do you want to just wrap it up, Lingi, with a few comments?
Yes. I think I'll do this presentation tomorrow. I think everybody's okay. Ready. And just to get the email, and I apologize for everybody. My internet just gave up on me.
No problem.
But I think I'll do this presentation tomorrow. I think everybody's ready to be on break, and I apologize for that. But the email will be up, will be provided by Ari. And if you inquire in the email, and then we can, this will be much appreciated. Thank you for those who bought some work yesterday. Thank you very much. Now, vale.
Okay, great. Well, big round of applause to Lingi. That's really great, heart-lifting collection of work, and look forward to your comments tomorrow. So that's it for today. We're going to take a, depending on where you are, like a morning tea or lunch break, and we will resume at 12:30 Canberra time, and that's 2:30 in Suva for our economic session, and then day three starts 9 o'clock or 11 o'clock tomorrow morning. So thanks so much to all our speakers, all our chairs, and to our art curator. Great sessions this morning, and see you this afternoon. Bye for now.